So now we have carefully built tables, we've defined the shape of those tables, we've put foreign key columns in the tables, and we've put data in the tables where we work from sort of the outside edge, we work from the outside edges in. So we insert these things, then we have these proxy numbers, and then we use the proxy numbers to represent these pointer relationships. This points to that relationship. And so these little numbers model the pointers. Now we have to reconstruct it, right? We went all this effort to effectively create a highly compressed, highly performant representation of our data, but our user doesn't want to see number one when they see Led Zeppelin. They don't want to see, oh, what does this track belong to? Well, it belongs to artist number one. No, no, no. They want to see Led Zeppelin. So we have to reconstruct this all back up. So this is the power, right? The power is we've got this efficient storage model, and we got to work across these foreign keys. We got to sort of defeat the foreign keys, as it were. We've got these numbers, but we don't want the numbers. We want the actual strings. And this is the join operation. This is part of SQL. Join is an SQL keyword. And there's an on clause that basically says, this is how I want the connection between these two tables to be made. The join says, I want to select from more than one data from multiple tables. And the on clause says how all that data is going to be connected. Okay, so here is a select statement with a join clause. Make sure my pen is working. And so here we want to basically see in our user interface, we don't want to see that who made who comes from artist two. We want to see that who made who comes from AC/DC. But it turns out that AC/DC and who made who are in two separate tables. And so we have to reconnect the data. We're not reconnecting it in the database. We're only reconnecting it at the moment we're displaying it to the user. So we're going to retrieve rows. Select is the SQL that lets us retrieve rows. So we have a little different syntax here. We say album.title, that's table name.field name. I want to see the album title and the artist name. So we're pulling fields from two tables. From, that's standard SQL, album joined with artist. Joined, the word with isn't there. So now we have two tables. There are two tables, table one, table two, that hold the data. So I want to get data from these two tables somehow glued together to create sort of a momentary view that is the data across both tables. And the on clause is an SQL keyword, and it basically says, when do I want to connect the rows? What's the definition of the corresponding rows? And this is like and all we basically say is, I'm interested in these virtual rows to happen when the album's artist ID field, which is this field, is equal to the artist's artist ID field. Join these two rows together when that's true. You can join them all, and then it'd be all combinations for both tables. You can try this in your system without the on clause, and it'll go, pew, you will get four records. You get all combinations. The on clause reduces the combinations to only the ones that match. Okay? So that produces this output. Okay? Now, if you want to sort of see a little bit more what's going on, we can change it. And the only thing we're changing in this one is we're adding this little bit right here. We're going to look at this column and this column, which are the connector columns, right? So this is the foreign key from one table and the primary key in another table. So we're like, give me the album's title, give me the album's artist ID column, give me the artist's artist ID column, and the artist name. And the rest of this from, album, join, that's all the same as before. And so what we see in the output right here is we see these extra three things, these extra two things, which are the connector fields. And you'll see that the only thing we see is when they're equal. And that's how we link up the data in this table with the data in this table for the join. So normally we don't show these and we don't see this part right here. We only see the connected up data. But here we can sort of be a little more explicit to see the connected up data and see how the connections are being made. And again, for a good time, run this query and take this on clause out and see what you see. Okay? See what you see. And so we can do the same kind of thing where we want to connect the genre ID to the genre, right? So we're going to select the track title and the genre name from track joined with the genre table. That means we're getting data from two tables, right? From track and genre. Some would actually just put a comma here. Some variants of SQL, but we're not doing that one. They'll just say track comma genre because it's just saying it's really coming out of two tables. The on clause again says show me the ones where this is the case, where the track genre ID, which is this field, is equal to the genre's genre ID. And so again, out comes the information that we are looking for. And it can get really complex, and this is where how you named your fields and track and tables makes a lot of sense, can make a lot of sense, a lot more sense for you. And it takes a while to type this in, right? But the patterns are real simple. And we're now going to create this output right here, which is effectively the output that we want to create. And note that there's replication. There's string replication because the user wants to see it this way, but we don't want to store it that way. So we're going to select track title, artist name, album title, genre name. Those are the things we want to see. That's part of a select statement. From the track joined with genre, joined with album, joined with artist. We're going to pull data from four tables. And we want to connect the data on clause, when to connect the data. And now we have to connect all of the little foreign keys. So if you recall, we had three little arrows. And you can each one of these is one of our arrows. The genre arrow, the arrow between album and track, and then the arrow between artist and album. And then we put ands in between, and. So that tells us how to link the tables. You could do this again without the on clause and it'd be interesting, but basically these get long, but they really are a simple pattern once you understand. I tend to start with the thing I want and then I kind of go in the order, but the order really doesn't matter. Because all you're really saying is this is the superset of all the tables I'm interested in. And so I draw them in order, kind of starting from the most central thing and then moving out, because I think of it as looking up things in those other tables. But you can put them in any order. The order is not essential. And so we went through all this process to create our user interface that had a bunch of replication in it. In the middle, there is a data model that doesn't have representation. So we stick it all in and we use join to pull it back out. And we've done this, and the value of all of this, of course, is not that it's easy. If it were easy, we would just put it in a flat file separated by commas and use split or something. But that's what makes it perform. Now, the one thing in addition that we mentioned, if you go all the way back to when we created the tables, was the concept of on-delete cascade, okay? And so here we have the arrow that we originally were drawing this way because we were thinking of looking up the genre in the genre table. But you can think of this as sort of the parent row and a child row. And the key thing is if we are to delete this row using a statement like this, if we're to delete this row, that would break these references. When we say onDelete cascade, what we're really saying is when you delete from a table where there are references back to that table for the particular row or rows that you deleted, wipe out those child rows. So it's cascading a delete, cascading to the corresponding rows where it matches. That's why it's called onDelete cascade. And there might be many tables. It just so if you deleted a artist, it would delete all the albums for the artist, then it would delete all the tracks for the albums, right? And so the cascade tells MySQL to keep our references clean. Now, we don't delete that often, and there's other tricks, but onDelete cascade is a very, very nice thing to do to make sure that you don't end up with broken links so your joins keep working. And so after onDelete cascade, it would wipe out those two rows, and there would only be those two rows left. There's a number of choices that you can have in onDelete cascade. You can restrict. Don't allow changes that break constraints, which means you can't delete that parent row. Cascade, which is what I just talked about, which means it adjusts the child rows. And set null means that you sort of empty out. You change the two to like null, which is not exactly zero. It's the lack of a value in SQL.